Thank you for joining us. I'm Laurel Westendorf, part of the Community Relations team at the Deschutes Public Library. Today's program is Who is the Liberated Woman? Presented by Michelle Seiler-Godfrey. Michelle has a Ph.D. in history from the University of Iowa. Her dissertation explored late medieval English towns, and her area of focus included legal and gender history. Michelle has previously taught at Austin Community College and the University of Iowa. She is currently the Program Development Manager at the High Desert Museum in Bend, Oregon. Thank you, Michelle, for covering this topic for us.
Thank you. And just launching in, the question I posed with this talk is, who is the liberated woman? Doing just a quick Google image search of liberated woman brings up a surprising number of images featuring a female outline in a dramatic pose against an open landscape background. Apparently, at least on Google, liberated women are women who go outside to jump and kick. It also brought this up, which is not necessarily an encouraging symbol for the liberated woman. So what do we really mean by liberated woman? In the last 60 years, there have been several changes for women from the average age of first marriage to opportunities to enter new professions that have been used to signify the increasingly liberated woman. In the 1960s, the average age of first marriage for women was 20 years old and had hovered around 20 since around 1940s. In 1982, it rose to 22, and today it is significantly higher at 28. In 1968, only 37% of college graduates were women, with the majority being men. By the 1980s, it was more 50-50, where half of college graduates were women and half were men. And actually today, women are the majority of college graduates, where well over half. By 2010, it was 55%. Women have more opportunity to work in professional fields in the past 60 years. We see this increase like with lawyers. The percentage of lawyers who are women rose from 1960 at 2% to 15% in 1983. And today, 38% of lawyers are women. We also see this with physicians. In 1950, only 6% of physicians were women. In 1990, it was 17%, and today it's 36%. These changes have their foundations in the women's liberation movement in the late 1960s and 70s. In this talk, I'm going to explore the different ways women and the media define the liberated woman during this time, and what their battles over this definition means for women today. Before we launch into the women's liberation movement in the 1970s, it is important to understand the foundations of this activism. Feminist movements are often discussed in waves, with the focus first focusing on suffrage up to the 1920s, and the second wave being in the 1960s and 1970s. However, there was more of a continuous movement, or sometimes talked about as movements because there were so many different components, throughout the 20th century that is important to recognize. Activism between the 1930s and 1960s tended to be connected to labor movements and focus on low-income women and women of color. For example, in 1937, labor activist Wolfgang organized a sit-down strike at Woolworths in Detroit. Female workers stayed inside the store for 6 nights and 7 days, protesting for higher wages. Dubbed the Girl Strikers by the national press, they eventually won wage increases of 20 to 25%, union recognition, and more say over scheduling. Inspired by these events, retail workers in other major cities similarly struck and won gains. Second wave feminism builds on these movements, but it was also distinct from them. Women's liberation during the late 1960s and 1970s increasingly focused on challenging gender patterns and ending male dominance. Gender was increasingly recognized as a social structure. And in this framework, it was something that was socially constructed. So something that outside society built conceptions of gender rather than natural, which meant that other things once thought natural, such as marriage and heterosexuality, were also constructed by society. When something's constructed and not just naturally innate, it could be challenged. Sexism wasn't a fact. It could be unlearned. It could be changed. This view of gender gave rise to the personal is political slogan, which recognizes many of the problems thought to be private were actually created by social structures and connected women's personal liberation from these structures with societal changes. So basically, women's positions in the home or in their personal life could be changed by changing society in a larger sense. However, women within the movement differed on what liberation meant and what women needed to be liberated from. Published in 1963, Betty Friedan's The Feminine Mystique defined the feminine mystique as the assumption that women would be fulfilled from housework, marriage, and children alone, and had no desire for higher education, careers, or a political voice, and argued that women were unhappy with their lives because they were unable to live up to this feminine mystique. For Friedan and many women like her, women's liberation was the freedom of women to leave the home and pursue higher education and meaningful careers. And this quote is from the opening of that book, and it says, "The problem lay buried, unspoken, for many years in the minds of American women. It was a strange stirring, a sense of dissatisfaction, a yearning that women suffered in the middle of the 20th century in the United States. Each suburban wife struggled with it alone, as she made the beds, shopped for groceries, matched slip-cover material, ate peanut butter sandwiches with her children. She was afraid to ask, even of herself, the silent question, is this all?" This book has frequently been credited with launching the second wave of feminism that helped to break down barriers for women outside the home. Building from this work, in 1970, the National Organization for Women, or NOW, launched a Women's Strike for Equity march on the 50th anniversary of women's right to vote. This march was meant to show the American media the scope and power of second wave feminism. 50,000 feminists marched down New York City's Fifth Avenue and called for a national work stoppage in which women would cease cooking and cleaning in order to draw attention to women's domestic labor. It is unclear how many women went on strike, but there were sister demonstrations across the country, and following the event, NOW's membership grew by 50%. The movement focused on three specific goals that rose from Friedan's book: free abortion on demand, equal opportunity in employment and education, and the establishment of 24/7 childcare centers. At the same time, the book and the demands of this march also demonstrates how the feminist movement was dominated by white, middle-class women whose voices and priorities often silenced working-class women and women of color. In 1984, Black feminist theorist Bell Hooks made a searing indictment of Friedan in her book, From Margin to Center, stating that the focus of Friedan's book wasn't a universal female problem, but rather a problem endured only by white, upper and middle class women. She pointed out that Friedan ignored who would be called in to take care of the children and maintain the home if more women like her were freed from their house labor. And she did not address the needs of women without men, without children, without homes. Other women, such as women of color, didn't exist for Friedan. And this is a quote from her book. When Friedan wrote The Feminist Mystique, more than one third of all women were in the workforce. Although many women longed to be housewives, only women with leisure time and money could actually shape their identities on the model of the feminine mystique. And so Bell Hooks is pointing out that while for middle class or upper class women, freedom might be getting outside the home, for other women, it could be actually being able to make the choice to stay at home. Audre Lorde made a similar critique of the women's liberation movement. A Black homosexual woman, Lorde was vocal about how she was often the token Black or lesbian speaker, and argued that leaders of the movement needed to expand their vision to embrace differences among women. In this poem, Lorde critiques those who define themselves as feminists but continue to benefit from the oppression of other groups. And the point is, there are so many roots to the tree of anger that sometimes the branches shatter before they bear. Sitting in Edricks, the women rally before they march, discussing the problematic girls they hire to make them free. An almost white counterman passes a waiting brother to serve them first, and the ladies neither notice nor reject the slighter pleasures of their slavery. I, who am bound by my mirror as well as my bed, see causes and color as well as sex, and sit here wondering which me will survive all these liberations. And so really pointing out that disconnect between white women and her experiences, raising a lot of questions of what will happen to women of color, lower class women, when these ladies leave the home, they'll be having to step in to do this housework. And will they have equal pay? Will they have freedom? Another example of how white middle class women in the feminist movement were disconnected from lower income or women of colors issues can be seen in two different events involving bras. In 1968, women organized the first protest against the Miss America pageant in Atlantic City. The protest featured freedom trash cans into which women could throw away their physical manifestations of women's oppression, such as bras, curlers, wigs, and issues of Cosmopolitan and Ladies Home Journal. These trash cans later became the basis of the myth of bra-burning feminists. The trash cans were never actually set on fire, but a columnist in the Post reported that they were. This event gave the women's liberation a lot of visibility and is often credited with launching the second wave. In contrast, in 1971, Ann Draper, a 1938 Hunter College graduate and garment worker organizer, testifying in front of the California Industrial Welfare Commission for raising the minimum wage, held aloft a tattered Woolworth bra and stated that many women, given their low income, could afford at best one bra every couple of years. This one, she stated, only lasted a few washes. So while at the 1968 protest of Miss America, women could easily afford to toss away their bras, Ann Draper argued that many women lacked the ability to even buy bras. And so once again, showing that disconnect between how do we define the woman, liberated woman. Many feminists of color similarly argued that their experiences and priorities were different and not recognized by the white leaders of the feminist movement. Barbara Emerson, the daughter of Hosea Williams, a civil rights leader who worked with Martin Luther King, stated it was a white woman's movement, not necessarily because it was exclusionary of women of color, but simply because the agenda was a white woman's agenda. Women's liberation meant something different for women of color. Emerson went on to discuss how intertwined feminism and civil rights was for her, quote, "It's different for me, if not impossible, to make a distinction between my feminism or myself as a feminist and myself as a civil rights activist, because the two were so intricately bound. I didn't see a distinction, but I named the civil rights movement. I claimed that because that was what was essential." Many feminists of color found that neither the feminist nor civil rights activism encompassed their experiences or priorities. So several formed their own groups. One such group was the Combee River Collective, which was founded in 1974 and is often seen as laying the foundation for Black feminism. Co-founder Barbara Smith stated that the women's liberation movement, quote, "was hard for me to grasp from my perspective because white women were so privileged," unquote. The name of this collective came from Harriet Tubman, who led a campaign that freed more than 750 slaves at South Carolina's Combee River in 1863. The collective implemented a grassroots approach to address issues that plagued Black women, including forced sterilization. Another group, the Third World Women's Alliance, was created to bring together Black women and Latinas. The name reflected the description of people of color in the United States as sharing the oppression of third world people. Their foundation was that women of color had to struggle against race, class, and gender domination at the same time. Other women took a more radical approach to liberation and advocated for the complete liberation for men. Launched by Firestone in 1969, the Red Stockings called for women to unite to achieve liberation for men as the agents of oppression. They argued that the traditional family structure was at the core of women's oppression and that the feminist goal should be the elimination of sex distinction itself. Although these different strands of the movement have often been seen as signs of disunity and therefore weakness, in fact, women's movements were actually stronger and more successful when there were multiple groups representing different experiences and priorities. Rather than a weakening, it strengthened feminist activism overall and produced so much wide-scale change in the 1970s that in 1975, Time awarded its Man of the Year, at that point it was still called Man of the Year, to American women. The article states, quote, "They have arrived like a new immigrant wave in male America. They may be cops, judges, military officers, telephone linemen, cab drivers, pipe fitters, editors, business executives, or mothers and housewives, but not quite the same subordinate creatures they were before. Across the broad range of American life, from suburban track houses to state legislators, from church pulpits to army barracks, women's lives are profoundly changing, and with them, the traditional relationships between the sexes. 1975 was not so much the year of the woman as the year of the women. An immense variety of women altering their lives, entering new fields, functioning with new senses of identity, integrity, and confidence, unquote. To explore this diversity of movements in more depth, we're going to look at these changes through the lens of six different areas and what the successes mean for women today. These are meant to be examples of the range of issues that women worked on, and they are definitely not all inclusive. First, looking at what does liberation mean in relation to women's bodies? One of the issues most often associated with the women's liberation movement is reproductive freedom. By the mid-20th century, people were asserting more control over planning their reproductive lives, and sex outside of marriage was becoming increasingly acceptable. In 1960, the pill was approved for contraceptive use, and by 1962, almost 1.2 million American women were on the pill. Although until 1972, the pill was restricted to married couples, many single women found ways to get it. This growing use of contraception led to more opposition to bans on abortion. In 1973, the landmark case Roe v. Wade determined that banned abortions were unconstitutional. Although the case successfully opened access to safe abortions and significantly reduced the number of deaths related to abortion, it remains one of the most contentious cases in the public sphere. And increasingly, access to legal abortion is out of reach for many women because of lack of funds, insurance or welfare not covering it, or need to travel a large distances to find someone who can perform it. Another aspect of reproductive freedom includes the right to choose to have a child and the movement against forced sterilization. Poor women and people of color have frequently been subjected to involuntary sterilization. These forced sterilizations were often based on racist stereotypes. For example, in 1973, Alabama authorities sterilized Minnie Lee and Mary Alice Roof, African Americans aged 14 and 12, without their consent or the consent of their mother, on the grounds that they were at risk of early sexual activity. In 1975, 10 Mexican-American women in Los Angeles filed a lawsuit against obstetricians who had coerced them into sterilization. One of the plaintiffs testified that, quote, while I was in advanced labor and in great pain, the doctor told me that I had too many children, that I was poor, an burden to the government, and I should sign a paper not to have more children, that my tubes can be untied later at a later time and I could still have children, unquote. In the case, the judge ruled against the women. In response, activists formed a national organization, the Committee for Abortion Rights and Against Sterilization Abuse, based on women should have the right to decide their reproductive options. For the group, this not only included legal rights, but economic and social rights that would give women true reproductive freedom. In 1979, the group was successful in the passage of stringent federal regulations against involuntary sterilization. Another related issue was the right to freedom from bodily harm, including domestic abuse and rape. To unmask violence that impacted women, the women's movement had to redefine this violence, and most of the 1970s was about raising awareness and redefining what it meant for violence against women. Historically, male punishment of wives, which included pushing or slapping, was acceptable and not considered domestic violence. Additionally, rape was traditionally defined as something done by a stranger on the street and didn't recognize that the majority of rapes are perpetrated by people who know the victim. In the 1970s, women funded numerous women's shelters and other supportive services, and in 1984, the Family Violence Prevention and Services Act was passed, which provided federal grants to help prevent violence against women. Closely related to women and their bodies is the right to advocate for their own health. Published in 1971, Our Bodies Ourselves increased women's knowledge of their own bodies, something that hadn't been accessible to women before, including subjects generally considered taboo, such as sexuality. It also promoted new attitudes that women should learn about their bodies and could make decisions about their own health care. In print and regularly updated for over 40 years, in 2018, the organization announced that it will cease producing updated versions. Women advocating for their health sparked changes in healthcare, including increasing number of female physicians and making it no longer acceptable to only study male diseases or use male subjects in drug testing. Despite significant advances in women's health as a result, women today continue to receive unequal healthcare. Physicians are more likely to dismiss their health concerns, and women are less likely to receive medical intervention for pain management and cardiovascular care than men. This is even more true for women of color. Black mothers are much more likely to die from pregnancy-related causes than are mothers of other racial and ethnic groups. Women of color are also disproportionately represented among women who are uninsured. Today, these structural disparities in healthcare are being seen with COVID-19, as it is significantly impacting people of color, including women of color. Another large area that women worked in was women in work. In the 1970s, feminists attempted to redefine what counted as work and push to have women be able to pursue new professions and new careers that had before been limited mainly to men. Through a wages for housework campaign, feminists argued that housework and child raising was work and should be paid. Although the campaign wasn't successful in actually getting wages for housework, it did raise awareness of how the economy depends on women's unpaid labor and how in most households, women did the majority of housework even if they worked outside the home. Increasingly, women demanded that men do more of their share of the housework, though the limitations of that are again being seen today with COVID-19 and the movement of both women and men working from home and women being and childcare being taken at home, education being done at home. A lot of those burdens are being seen as falling more on women at this point. And there's been a few studies showing like in academia, women are publishing less during this time than men, likely because of those household and childcare duties falling on them. In addition, in the 1970s, feminists worked against sex segregation of job advertisements and discriminatory hiring practices. Prior to 1970, job ads were frequently divided between male and female. For instance, ads in 1968 read, "Help, wanted, male. Office supervisor, wholesale distribution office offers rapid financial advancement to young man who learns overall operation quickly. Start $400. While another read, "Help wanted, female. General office gal Friday type for a stable personal lady in the one girl office, starting $80. The segregated employment ads were ruled unconstitutional by the Supreme Court in 1973. And women gained new opportunities and increasingly were seen in diverse workplaces. The percentage of female lawyers, as we've seen, tripled and physicians doubled in the 1970s. Women activists also advocated for better working conditions. In 1972, 4,000 Latinx garment workers launched a 2-year strike at the Farrah Company in El Paso, Texas. Before the strike, raises were based on favoritism and there was no job security or health and safety regulations. The lack of these basic rights caused women to walk out. Many of these women during this period lost their homes, cars, everything with the strike, but they were able to spark a national boycott and eventually gained union recognition. One of the workers, however, pointed out how her and other strikers did not see themselves as part of the larger women's liberation movement, saying, "I don't believe in burning your bra, but I do believe in having our rights." Despite advances in the workplace, women continue to face a pay gap. In 1970, women earned an average 59% of men's wages, and the gap didn't begin to narrow until the mid-1980s. Today, it takes Black women in the U.S. 20 months to earn what white men make in a year. While the gender wage gap still exists, women represent the majority of college graduates, and their participation in professions before bar to them has steadily increased. The third area that we're looking at where women really worked in the 1970s was in academia. Women in the 1970s not only continued to go to college in greater numbers, but also increasingly pursued master's and doctorate degrees. These female college students rarely encountered a female professor, and in graduate school, they were often one of the few women in the program and faced a number of discriminatory practices. However, as women earned higher degrees and became faculty at universities, they not only were able to mentor women students, but they also radically transformed what was taught. In fields such as literature and history, women were traditionally considered marginal genres. In 1970, the first women's studies program, founded at San Diego State College, moved women from the margins to the center. By the 1980s, scholarship about women and gender flourished and radically changed how we viewed history, literature, and other subjects. And for a concrete example of this, renowned medieval historian and my own dissertation advisor, Connie Berman's work on Cistercian nuns in the 1980s challenged what scholars had traditionally believed about monasteries in the Middle Ages, from how and when they were founded and organized to how they operated economically. Her work earned her more than a few scathing and personal critiques from male historians and one particularly angry German monk. And she's actually exceedingly proud of the monk's critique of her and has all her students read his published article against her, usually multiple times. Since 2009, women have earned the most doctoral degrees awarded in the United States, about 53% each year. So each year women are the majority of people graduating with doctoral degrees. In colleges and universities, 45% of full-time faculty are women, but only 26% of tenured professors are women, meaning women are being hired more for roles of instructors, lecturers, and assistant professors. Only 3% of full-time faculty are Black females. Another major area is women in politics. The 1970s marked a series of firsts for women in politics. In 1968, Shirley Chisholm became the first Black woman elected to Congress. In Congress, she introduced more than 50 pieces of legislation and worked for racial and gender equality. In 1972, Fighting Shirley became both the first woman and first African-American to run for the nomination of a major party for the President of the United States. Her slogan, Unbought and Unbossed, was a statement of independence. Despite being a candidate of substance and experience, she wasn't able to consolidate support for women and minorities and lost the nomination to George McGovern. In an interview towards the end of her life, Chisholm stated, "I want history to remember me, not as the first Black woman to have made a bid for the presidency of the United States, but as a Black woman who lived in the 20th century and who dared to be herself. I want to be remembered as a catalyst for change in America." From Texas, Barbara Jordan was the first African-American woman elected to the Texas Senate, and with her election to president of the Texas Senate, she became the first Black woman in America to oversee a legislative body. In 1972, she became the first African-American woman elected to Congress from the South since 1898. In 1975, she was a prominent voice on the Judiciary Committee and launched the impeachment process against President Richard Nixon with a powerful speech. In 1974, Elaine Noble became the first openly lesbian or gay candidate elected to a state legislator when she was elected to the Massachusetts House of Representatives. And in 1976, Mary Rose Oker from Ohio became the first Arab American woman elected to Congress. And in 1981, Sandra Day O'Connor was appointed by President Ronald Reagan as the first woman ever to sit on the U.S. Supreme Court. Although the 1970s saw a number of firsts and several prominent women enter Congress, their numbers, percentage of women in Congress, didn't change much until the 1980s. The biggest jump, however, came in 1992. Known as the Year of the Woman, 24 women won election to the U.S. House of Representatives for the first time, and the number of women in the Senate tripled. The 2018 midterm elections could be termed another Year of the Woman. The U.S. House of Representatives elected a record number of women again, and women now comprise almost a quarter of both the House and Senate. The fifth area I'm wanting to look at is women in the arts. Although feminists raised questions about why so few female artists were in museums, women had little success in the 1970s breaking into the male-dominant fine arts. Instead, they had to find ways of presenting their art outside the traditional structures. Several Latinx muralists working in the Southwest in the 70s did just that. For example, Judy Becca launched her The History of California project in LA in 1974. The Half Mile Mural, known also as the Great Wall of Los Angeles, was completed in 1983 and depicts the history of California from the perspective of people who have not always been recognized, including women, minorities, and queer people. She worked with hundreds of teenagers, many from LA's juvenile justice program, to complete the wall. In a recent interview, she said back in the 70s, they, quote, called me a teacher, a social worker, even a gang member, everything but an artist. This is not what art did. It did not intervene in social spaces, mitigating problems that these kids were facing. It was so foreign to the arts to be engaged in social justice action or transformative action within a community, unquote. Women, unfortunately, have continued to struggle to be represented in fine arts. A recent study by ArtNet found that between 2008 and 2018, only 11% of all work acquired by the country's top museums was by women. Of these, only 3% were by African-American female artists. They also found that although solo shows featuring female artists or group exhibitions in which the majority of artists were female has grown, these only account for 14% of all exhibitions. Finally, the last area looking at is women's in sports. Women's participation in sports changed dramatically in the 1970s, in large part due to two events. One was the tennis match between Billie Jean King and Bobby Riggs in 1973, known as the Battle of the Sexes. King at first declined Riggs' challenge to the Battle of the Sexes, but later accepted after another women's player, Margaret Court, lost to Riggs. Leading up to the event, Riggs was vocal about his opinion, stating that women belonged in the bedroom and kitchen, and that they did not have emotional stability to be athletes, and that he would set the women's lib movement back about another 20 years by beating King. On September 20th, 1973, the Astrodome in Houston had just over 30,000 people, and the atmosphere was more spectacle than tennis match. If there was any question about what the match was about, however, the men wearing t-shirts featuring cartoon pigs that read, "I am a male chauvinist," made it clear. King won decidedly, 6-4, 6-3, 6-3. She later said, "I knew it was very important to win the match, if I wanted people to take women's tennis and women seriously." The second event was the passage of Title IX of the Education Amendments of 1972, which states that, quote, "No person in the United States shall, on the basis of sex, be excluded from participation in, be denied the benefits of, or be subjected to discrimination under any educational program or activity receiving federal financial assistance," unquote. This means everyone has equal access to any program that receives federal financial assistance, including sports. This meant that public schools were required to provide girls and boys with equitable sport opportunities. Before Title IX, 1 in 27 girls played sport. Today, that number is 2 in 5. And there are numerous female star athletes. Mia Hamm was born the same year as the passage of Title IX, 1972, and she and her teammates in the U.S. women's soccer team that won the 1999 World Championship represented the first generation of women to grow up with strong institutional support for girls' sports. Despite significant gains in the world's sports, women still face a lot of challenges. For example, in most tennis tournaments, women earn 20% less than men. And only a few years ago, former Indian Wells CEO Raymond Moore said that female tennis players ride on the court coattails of men, meaning that the only reason anybody pays attention to tennis is because of the male players and not the women. So after kind of looking through these different areas and how women defined liberation and how they worked towards those goals, I want to shift gears a little bit and look at how media defined the single woman or women's liberation during the 1970s. As second wave feminists were working to define the women, liberated woman, media sources offered their own definitions that attempted to capitalize on the spending power of single women. Frequently, they sought to distance themselves from more radical women libers and hesitated to create feminist characters. Instead, they defined liberation as more of a lifestyle than political and typically featured women who had made it in a male-dominated world. You see these in advertisements. In 1968, Virginia Slims Cigarettes launched an advertising campaign that sought to capitalize on the image of the newly liberated woman through the slogan, "You've come a long way, baby." This long-running campaign, which lasted into the 1980s, typically featured a modern woman in vibrant colors against the background of historical images of women, meant to show women how far they'd come in asserting their independence. many of the historical images emphasize a stigma against women smoking, and particularly husbands being against women smoking. One actually showed a husband kicking his wife out of the house for it. The one on the left here shows an outdated woman's work compared to her new work style, her new liberated. Other advertisements sought to capitalize on liberated women's sexuality. The ad on the left appeared in a 1974 Playboy and immediately received backlash from feminist groups, questioning where is the ad hoping to keep women? In 1971, National Airlines launched a, quote, Fly Me ad campaign, which also sparked protest over the blatant depiction of women as sex objects. Another ad in the campaign featured flight attendants saying, I'm going to fly you like you've never been flown before. Portrayals of a liberated woman began appearing in television series in the 1960s. Single women in television and film were not new, but the way they were able to move out of their parents' homes and into careers was. That Girl was one of the first sitcoms to focus on a single woman in this way. Running from 1966 to 1971, it featured urban single girl Anne Marie, played by Merle Thomas. Anne Marie was an inspiring actress and worked a series of temp jobs to support herself. She maintains a close relationship with her parents, though lives outside the home, and is in a monogamous relationship with Donald Hollinger that will clearly one day mature into marriage. In the last season, Anne Marie and Donald get engaged, and while many wanted to see the series end with a wedding, Thomas was against the idea and argued for Anne Marie remaining single. Instead of a wedding, the last episode actually features the engaged couple attempting to go to a women's liberation movement. The episode begins with Anne Marie upset about an article Donald wrote about the women's liberation movement because she believes it is about her. Donald argues, quote, I wrote this article about a girl who believes in women's liberation and freedom for women and independence. Now, you're certainly not that girl. Are you that girl? Donald soon finds out that she is when she argues that men don't play poker or go to hockey games with women because they are insecure about their masculinity and insists that he goes to her women's liberation meeting rather than a hockey game. On the way to the meeting, however, Anne Marie and Donald get trapped in an elevator while they use flashback episodes to argue about different women's liberation issues. For example, Donald argues that the main problem with women's liberation movement is amnesia. He states, quote, all the things you ladies are asking for, you have and have had. The problem is you don't remember having it. You say you don't have independence. You do have it. You just keep forgetting that as a woman, you can't do everything, unquote. When Anne Marie argues that women can do anything, Donald brings up several jobs that Anne Marie failed at, including shoe salesman and department store clerk. Donald also argues that women turn to men for protection and that women cannot cope with situations on their own. Anne Marie states that women can protect themselves and, quote, if men respected us more, we wouldn't have to do so much protecting, unquote. By the time the elevator gets unstuck, the women's liberation meeting is over, so Donald heads to his hockey game. When he comes home, he discovers that Anne Marie has been studying hockey and can even provide some examples of female hockey players. Donald states that he doesn't mind women being in hockey. In fact, quote, there is just one place they should keep women out of, women's liberation meetings, unquote. This is the last line in the entire series. It's how the episode ends. It's how the series ends. Clearly, despite advocating for the single girl, that girl is not ready to embrace the women's liberation movement. Similar to other shows and media portrayals at the time, that girl embraced the lifestyle of the single girl, but stopped short of the more radical notions of the women's liberation. That Girl is often seen as a precursor for the Mary Tyler Moore Show, which became an epitome of lifestyle feminism in 1970s TV. Begun in 1970, the show featured Mary Richards, an unmarried, independent woman in her 30s, focused on her career as an associate producer at WJM News in Minneapolis. In the show, Mary establishes a career in a traditionally male-dominated profession, and her life centers on her career and circle of friends, with dating being more of a side story. The lyrics of the theme song capture this focus on Mary's independent lifestyle. In season one, the lyrics focus on her being on her own, but question how she's going to achieve this independence. They open with this question, how will you make it on your own? The world is awfully big, girl. This time you're all alone. But it's time you started living. It's time you let someone else do some giving. Love is all around. No need to waste it. You can never tell. Why don't you take it? You might just make it after all. And you can go online and find it there where someone can actually sing it much better than I just said it. But interestingly, the lyrics to the theme song change after season one. And no longer have this question mark about her making it on her own or these statements about independence. It becomes a lot more happy and hopeful. And at the end, it says, you're going to make it after all. And the reason producers say the decision was made to change the lyrics was that clearly with the show, she has made it. And so they felt like it should no longer be questioning. It should be this more upbeat and assertive that she has made it. And focusing on an independent, single, working woman, the show demonstrates many of the choices Mary had to make in navigating this independence, particularly in a male-dominated workplace. In the first episode, Mary appears at the news station to interview for a clerical position when her boss, Lou Grant, offers a position of associate producer at a much lower pay. And throughout the series, Mary frequently performed more the role of secretary than producer. At times, however, she is offered more of a leadership position at the station and on occasion fills in for Lou as the boss. Often these episodes end with her trying to find her way out of a mistake. They're not really statements of her being able to fully become the boss and fully manage, nor statements of her not being able to do it. It kind of sits in the middle and almost in some ways, at least for me, in an unsatisfying way when I'm like, I want so much more. But I think for the time period, something that was a little bit more out there of her actually stepping up and becoming the boss. The opening episode of the third season addresses many of these themes. The episode begins with Mary preparing for a meeting with the station management. When her friend Rhonda asks why she is so nervous about the meeting, Mary states, "It used to be I felt like I could be myself. Now I feel like I represent women everywhere because she is often the only woman in the room." During her prep work, she discovers that her predecessor made $50 a week more than her. Angry, Mary storms into her boss's office and at first has trouble articulating the issues because of her tears. When he dismisses her as just having a woman thing, Mary speaks up to ask why the last associate producer made $50 a week more. Without hesitating, Lou responds, "Oh, because he's a man." He goes on to reassure her that it has nothing to do with her performance. She only makes less because she is a woman, as if it's just, that's the fact. When she argues with him, Lou states he had a family to support. You don't. Mary responds that financial need has nothing to do with it, or a man with three kids would be paid more than a man with one. At this point, one of her male co-workers interrupts to ask a trivial question, and Lou finds an escape out of his office. In the next scene, at the meeting with the station manager, Mary is asked to express her opinion on the station format, and the manager comments that Mary rarely speaks up during these meetings. At that point, she voices an opinion different from Lou's, her boss's, that the station manager prefers, further upsetting Lou. Later, during a disastrous newscast, the anchorman, Ted, is constantly interrupting Mary when she's trying to give some facts, and she yells at him to shut up. Lou decides at that point her assertiveness has earned her a paid raise and agrees to give her an extra $25 a week. When Mary protests and points out that that's not enough, he says he will try to find the 50. Although Mary ends making the same as her predecessor, the episode does not make any larger statements about the pay gap or women's right to equal pay. It's a lot more situational to Mary Richards. Mary Richards also had sexual self-determination, where she was free to make choice decisions about dating and premarital sex. The most of this was only hinted at in the series. The series primarily focused on her work life, with dating just really being kind of something that appeared on occasion. Though there were several episodes that indicated she was dating freely and making her own decisions about sex. For example, in the third season, her parents moved to an apartment around the corner so they can keep an eye on her. And when they moved there, and keeping an eye on her, they catch her staying out all night. They ask repeatedly where she was during the night, and each time Mary refuses to answer, asserting that what she did is her own business. The show ends And just really with that, making a case that she had the right to choose. If she wanted to stay out with a man an entire night, she could, and it wasn't her parents' business to insert themselves into her life. Though again, it doesn't have a sure definite, she was out with a man or she was having sex. It was something that was hinted at. The show ends without her being in a relationship, emphasizing the fulfillment of her co-workers and friends and making a statement that she did not need to be in a relationship. Wonder Woman had long served as a popular image of feminist messages, although an often problematic one. When Gloria Steinem launched Miss Magazine in 1971, a magazine founded by second wave feminists to highlight important feminist issues, the first cover featured Wonder Woman because, as Steinem stated, looking back at the Wonder Woman stories from the 40s, I am amazed by their strength of their feminist message. In addition, Steinem and the editors of Miss published a collection of Golden Age Wonder Woman comics with introductions by Steinem and essays by other prominent feminist writers. In the publication, Steinem wrote that Wonder Woman was, quote, just one small isolated outcropping of a larger human memory, and the girl children who love her are responding to one small echo of dreams and capabilities in their own forgotten past. In addition to emphasizing Wonder Woman as a role model, Steinem goes on to link her to the priorities of the feminist movement, stating Wonder Woman was a, quote, version of the truisms that women are rediscovering today, that women are full human beings, that we cannot love others until we love ourselves, and that love and respect can only exist between equals. While many of the 40s comics did feature a strong woman, in 1968, Wonder Woman decides to relinquish her powers to save Steve Trevor, and the comic book Diana Prince is reduced to cliches. In Wonder Woman number 182, as Diana is shown trying on clothes in London with a new admirer, the narration reads, quote, happiness for any healthy red-blooded young gal is bedecking herself in the latest fashion finery, and our Wonder Woman just happens to be a healthy red-blooded young gal. With her new stylish look, Diana attracted the attention of a series of new suitors, many of whom turn out to be villains. In 1972, there was an attempt at a special women's liberation issue of Wonder Woman. Diana's friend Kathy, fired up from a women's lib movement, is angry at Diana for taking a job at Grandy's department store because he underpaid his female employees. When asked to join her women's lib group, Diana responds, I'm for equal wages too, but I'm not a joiner. I wouldn't fit in with your group. In most cases, I don't even like women. When Grandy's goons attack the women's lib group, Diana saves the day, but as a result of the attack, the department store is shut down and the issue ends with a mob of angry women accusing the women's liberation group of taking away 250 jobs. This was not a very supportive message from the women's liberation cause. Wonder Woman also made appearances on the small screen in the 1960s and 70s. A television movie starring Linda Carter as Wonder Woman aired in 1975, and by April 1976, it became a TV series. In some of the first episodes, Wonder Woman voiced messages of empowerment, such as, women are the wave of the future, and sisterhood is stronger than anything. Although these more obvious messages of feminism didn't last long, Wonder Woman was powerful, independent, virtuous, and represented the ultimate good, a standard so high, no normal woman could actually achieve it. During the first season, an exchange between Steve and Etta Candy illustrates this point. Steve shakes, she's a wonder, strong, fearless, and still compassionate. All the virtues of femininity with none of the vices. Etta responds, you're right. Sometimes I wish I was like Wonder Woman. Steve says, there's only one Wonder Woman, Etta. And then Diana interjects her sage advice. Etta, I think the most we can do is be the best women we can possibly be. Over time, the television series took a less feminist approach and increasingly distanced from women's liberation. Few media portrayals featured single women of color. One notable exception was the television series Get Christy Love, which ran for one series in 1974. In it, Teresa Graves played the undercover African-American female police detective, Christine. Much of the series centers on the police captain's efforts to rein in Christine's unconventional tactics, and episodes tend to downplay her race. In one episode, a suspect asked her if she feels like the, quote, female Jackie Robinson of the LAPD. She said that she isn't, and lists a number of other female police officers who preceded hers, stating the opportunity is there, and that's what I'm interested in. Although the single independent woman increasingly became part of the mainstream media in the 1970s, Few of these women in movies or TVs would associate themselves with the women's liberation movement, seeing it as too liberal for them. This critique of the women's liberation movement was a major part of the backlash it faced in the later 1970s. After decades of work, the Equal Rights Amendment to the Constitution passed the legislature in 1972 and was sent to the states for ratification. The language of the ERA simply said that equality of rights under the law shall not be denied or abridged by the United States or by any state on account of sex. The amendment, however, quickly became the target of the backlash against the women's liberation movement, as many people feared the way it was changing traditional structures. Some of the biggest resistance came from women who had built their identities on motherhood and homemaking and now felt that tradition and identity were threatened. Led by Illinois lawyer Phyllis Schlafly, these anti-feminists sought to uphold an established family structure. Schlafly's Stop ERA campaign successfully defeated the ERA, with only 35 of the required 38 states ratifying it. She claimed that the amendment would, quote, destroy the family, foster homosexuality, and hurt women. It would lead to unisex toilets and drafting of women into combat. It would allow husbands to opt out of supporting their wives. Despite the defeat of the ERA and many of the limitations of the women's liberation movement I discussed today, I want to emphasize, one, the successes that we talked about today, the ways women became able to make more choices about themselves and their careers and what they did, and also that there are many reasons we should be hopeful and not discouraged. And one of those reasons is because increasingly feminism is being embraced and used for activism today. The term feminism had traditionally carried a lot of misconceptions and heavy negative baggage. And not long ago, many women distanced themselves from being, quote, the F word. A library talk I gave just a few years ago highlighted how many female celebrities stated they were not a feminist because of misconceptions about the term. However, the past few years, people have increasingly embraced the term. In 2012, Nigerian author Adichie gave a viral TED talk titled "We Should All Be Feminists," where she discusses coming to embrace the term feminism. Upon being told she couldn't call herself a feminist because feminists are women who are unhappy because they cannot find a husband, she decided to call herself a happy feminist. On being told feminism was un-African, she decided to call herself a happy African feminist. She kept adding qualifiers until she got to a happy African feminist who does not hate men and likes to wear lip gloss and high heels for herself and not for men. Adichie argues against needing to use these qualifiers. She says a feminist is simply a person who believes in the social, political, and economic equality of sexes. And that TED talk was eventually transformed into a really small book that I highly recommend by the same title, We Should All Be Feminists, where she really talks about this. It shouldn't have these qualifiers. Feminist is just this one simple definition. Beyonce built on this definition in her December 2013 anthem, Flawless. And she again reiterates that more simple definition of feminist is someone who believes in equal rights for men and women. The growth and popularity of feminism can be seen in merchandise ranging from shirts to tote bags to coffee mugs where people can proudly label themselves a feminist. But even more importantly, especially since 2016, feminism has become increasingly linked with activism. This can be seen in the Me Too hashtag. First coined by Tara Burke in 2007, it was popularized by celebrities in 2017, particularly with mounting allegations of sexual harassment against Harvey Weinstein, and became part of a movement toward embracing a more political and activist feminism. The silence breakers of the Me Too movement became the Time Person of the Year in 2017. The article equates these silent breakers and the Me Too movement they launched to Betty Friedan's identification of the problem that had no name in 1968 and the launching of the women's liberation movement. Another reason I'm hopeful is how the 2017 Women's March energized voters and spurred women into politics. In 2017, more than 3 million people gathered at events across the nation to protest the election of Donald Trump and advocate for women's rights. This electrified voters and started a surge of women entering politics. Only months after Trump's election, organizations that help women run for office saw large increases in demands for their services. As mentioned previously, the results of this we're starting to see as early as the 2018 midterm election, which was a big year for women in politics. And I think we should see similar growth as women increasingly become knowledgeable and build up experience in smaller political positions. They'll be able to move up into places like the U.S. Senate, U.S. House of Representatives, and hopefully one day the White House. And looking at what's happening now today in our world, I'm hopeful as well that we'll see more changes in the future and how these movements and marches and activism that's happening is starting to spur real change. So that's what I have with defining women's liberation. I don't know if I gave a definition, but those are some of the ways women's liberation were defined in the 1970s and ways that I think kind of building from that movement, we can be hopeful today. So thank you.
Thank you so much, Michelle. I really appreciated how you highlighted how diversity strengthens these movements and gave a broad scope of the intersectionality of who was included and not included in women's liberation. So thank you so much, Michelle.
Yeah, thank you.